Hello, Archbishop Lazar Puhalo is a retired bishop in the OCA, and he is a heretic. The evidence shows that he has been influenced by modernism, and I can't believe that he has the audacity to criticize St. Anthony's Monastery because of their belief in the toll houses, a concept which numerous Orthodox people and theologians believe in. But yet, on the other hand, Lazar attacks the teaching of the Holy Spirit that we find in the pages of Holy Scripture. See, Archbishop Lazar contradicts the Bible, and therefore he is an Antichrist because he's going against the teaching of the Holy Spirit. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are one. They're one being. So when you contradict the Holy Spirit, you're contradicting and going against Christ. So you're an Antichrist. In a certain sense, you're an Antichrist. You're anti-God. I'll get to the examples in a moment, but we know from Scripture that the Holy Spirit moved the men that were behind the Bible. 2 Peter 1:21 says, it says they were moved. The Greek word is pharomenoi. Forgive me if I mispronounced that word. And in 2 Timothy 3:16, St. Paul says that all Scripture is theonistos, God breathed, inspired. See, and the Lord Jesus had a high regard for Scripture. He said that not one jot or tittle shall pass away from the law till all be fulfilled. Scripture teaches that God's word is forever settled in heaven. And this is the revelation of God. So when Archbishop Lazar says that Eve did not come from Adam's rib, he is directly contradicting Genesis 2:22. He's contradicting and going against the Holy Spirit. Genesis 2 says that she did come from Adam's rib. Lazar says, no, she did not. And also, when he suggested that Adam and Eve may not have been historical personages, he was going against Scripture and the Holy Spirit as well. I don't see how a person can believe in the doctrine of the fall, sin, and the other doctrines such as the need for the Messiah and the incarnation of God, and the apostolic doctrine and the necessity of the church without first assuming the fall from paradise. See, the biblical apostolic gospel assumes that there was an historical Adam and Eve and an historical fall. This is part of the apostolic kerygma. And St. Paul says in Galatians 1 that if anyone comes preaching a gospel which they did not preach, let him be anathema, accursed. So the apostles assumed and taught, as did our Lord Jesus, that there was an historical Adam and Eve. So when Lazar contradicts that, he's introducing another gospel, and therefore I believe he falls under that anathema in Galatians 1. If you're going to remove the historical Adam and Eve, then you're going to do great damage to a lot of biblical passages. You're going to relativize Scripture and put it on the level of other religions. This is what I believe is the consequence of such a notion that Adam and Eve may not have been historical personages. Now, he didn't say they weren't historical. He just suggested that possibility. He said it's possible that they were not historical personages. And I would argue that it's not possible from a Christian standpoint. It's possible, perhaps, in paganism or atheism, but not in Christianity. To me, if you deny a historical Adam and Eve, you're not a Christian, you're a heretic, because you're going against the teaching of the Holy Spirit, as I pointed out. There are serious implications and consequences to the notion that Adam and Eve did not exist, and people need to think about these things. Lazar also suggests, or he didn't suggest, he actually believes in the idea that there are two authors behind the book of Isaiah. This is called the Deutero-Isaiah hypothesis. It comes from outside the church. It comes from deists. And Masonry, by the way, is deistic. So you need to connect the dots here. I'm not saying Lazar is a Mason, but I would argue that the demonic energy that is behind Masonry is perhaps influencing Lazar. And he says that Nineveh never repented in sackcloth and ashes. Well, Jonah chapter 3 says Nineveh did repent in sackcloth and ashes. So scripture says, let God be true, but every man a liar. St. Peter and the apostles said in Acts 5:29, we ought to obey God rather than men. So I couldn't care less what this heretic Lazar thinks. He's disobedient to the Holy Spirit. He's disobedient to scripture. He's disobedient to the teaching of the Orthodox Church. I have no idea why the OCA is allowing him to have a public platform to poison people's souls with his pernicious concepts, which are right out of hell. Okay, and people should not support him in any way, because by supporting him, you are, in essence, reinforcing him in his prelest, and this is not good. People need to take a stand. They need to defend the truth. And I have more information below in the description box about defending truth. Lazar also believes in evolution, and it is my position that a person cannot be a real Christian and believe in evolution unless you're going to first assume the evolution of dogma concept. You can't accept evolution, and the evolution of dogma cannot be maintained by anyone who is Orthodox. Orthodox rejects the concept of the evolution of dogma, and we can't believe it. So there are consequences to the idea of evolution. So Lazar is a heretic. He denies numerous Orthodox teachings, and I just can't believe that he has the audacity to attack St. Anthony's Monastery because of the aerial toll houses. And this man strains at gnats, it seems, but swallows camels. The things that he has innovated and introduced into Orthodoxy are more serious than the aerial toll houses. So he needs to repent. He needs to humble himself and be like a child and trust the scriptural teaching and the doctrine of the apostles and the teaching of the Holy Spirit, and distrust his thoughts and be obedient to the church. And, you know, I don't like when clergy and bishops are incompetent. When a bishop is consecrated, he gives vows that he will guard the church, not attack it. And when you attack biblical doctrine, you are attacking the doctrine of the church. You're attacking the Holy Spirit and the church. And he's just simply a heretic. And I think that he also holds to neo-orthodoxy. This is the idea that there are scientific and historical errors in the Bible. And this is all heretical. This stuff comes from outside the Orthodox Church. So he needs to repent and be obedient. And I recommend that people do not support him, because you're hurting his soul if you support him. Before I end this video, there's something else I want to mention here. In Acts 17, the Holy Spirit says that the Bereans were noble because they tested the claims of the Apostle Paul himself by the teaching of Holy Scripture. See, so we have every right to test the claims of a 20th, 21st century bishop by the teaching of Holy Scripture. See, it's the Holy Spirit who said they were noble in Acts 17 for testing the claims of the Apostle Paul daily. It says they studied the Scriptures daily to see if what they were being told was true, and the Holy Spirit says they were noble for doing that. St. John tells us to test the spirits, and St. Paul told us to test all things, hold fast to that which is good. So it is a part of biblical Christianity to test the claims of men. So because Lazar contradicts biblical teaching, he falls into the category of what scripture calls a false teacher. He's going against the Holy Spirit, and he is, in a certain sense, an antichrist for doing so. I thank you for your time.